On September 30th, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo will deliver keynote remarks at the U.S. Embassy to the Holy See's International Religious Freedom Symposium. Promoting and securing religious freedom is a shared priority for the United States and the Holy See. Today, however, more than 80% of the world's population lives in countries where restrictions on religious liberty prevail. Join us as we discuss current threats to religious freedom and the diplomatic tools that governments and faith-based organizations can use to advance and defend this unalienable right.
So, tomorrow is Advancing and Defending International Religious Freedom Through Diplomacy, September 30th, 2020. Now, there are currently various issues going on. Now, here's the press release from the U.S. Embassy to the Holy See, And we are currently in a very, very strange situation. While all states are currently in a corona lockdown, well, there is the issue of religious freedom. Is the issue of religious freedom, and so I'm So this is currently the live showing of the remembrance service in Halle. Here we have the chairman of the Central Council of Jews in Germany, Josef Schuster. While at the same time, now let's see if I'm going to the right place. Oh, so we have here these gentlemen, which are the Sanhedrin. They are members of the Sanhedrin who want to blow the shofar in Zion. Now there is a very, what can I say, very important issue with blowing the shofar. Because with blowing the shofar, you should count 7 times 7 years. And then all sins, all debts should be forgiven. And people should go back to their own land. Now the Jubilee 5777 already passed last year. So let's shortly listen to this, what happened here.
Wait a second.
Well, okay, this is on one side religious freedom to count the years and of course to blow the shofar, but as you can see here in the background, now it is forbidden for Jews to pray, to bring any religious instruments or to blow the shofar on the Temple Mount, the Har HaBayit, the most important piece of property for the Jewish people in the center and the heart of Jerusalem. Now, while we are having this event, so the shofar is blown in Zion, also the President of the United States made in his greetings remarks to the for Yom Kippur. He referred to blowing the shofar in Zion, but unfortunately it is forbidden, for Jews to go up here. So when we are speaking about religious, international religious freedom, okay, where the United States Foreign Minister, Secretary Mike Pompeo, is now talking to Archbishop Gallagher and Cardinal Parolin, who is the Holy See Secretary of State. Now we should take a short-term look, September 30th, what actually happened last year concerning exactly this remembrance. Now, unfortunately, during last Yom Kippur, during last Rosh Hashanah in Yom Kippur, we had an attack on the synagogue in Halle, which we called in. But what also was happened is the on the 30th of September, all right, the Pope Yeah, on the 30th September 2019, the Pope actually released a motu proprio, which is some sort of an executive order instituting the Sunday of the Word of God, on the Word of God. Now, this is extremely important now for everybody who is looking, yeah, for a solution concerning a peace between Israel and the nations as prescribed in the Bible. And I would like to go, I put out here some things, oops, I will go back here for a second. No. Now, it's very nice here. So, of course, I took this here because there is currently quite a number, or there is really panic in DC. And we have here now a House resolution condemning QAnons rejecting the conspiracy theories. So I pull this up. So this is a resolution of the House. And why I bring this up is because, well, in the Bible, or in the Bible, there is recognized a so-called source Q, because nobody really knows who wrote the Gospels, and there it is basically thought of that there is one source Q in theology. Let me bring this go up. Q theologie, Quelle Q. So it calls the source Q. No, so this is in direct connection with the biblical references. Okay, so who was the logical source? Who was the spirit? Who was the Rema behind the Gospels, the Synoptic Gospels of Mark, Matthew, and Luke? So John does not belong to this source, interestingly. No, so the Gospel of John is a very, very particular, different kind of gospel. But there is a so-called source Q, which brings up, the idea that behind various information in the Bible, well, there is a source Q. Now, as a German, I follow this thing here up, and I found this quite interesting that Q is Q, besides the fact that Q stands for the letter 17 and some other issues. Now, so how is this connected with the House Resolution 1154, which talks about all kinds of stuff? So it's basically, when I read this, as a guy from Germany, who is the founding country for the Antifa, the anti-fascist movement, when I see the accusation, what the House here wants to resolve, I say, wait a second, what they are describing actually, this is exactly what the anti-fascist movement is doing. And they want to put this into the shoes, so to speak, of people who follow the source, who want to know, who want to see through various lies and deceptions within the media. And I know there are a lot of Christians amongst there who pray, who want to see peace for their country, who bless their country, and they want to see one nation under God. What the Democrats and socialists and Democrats want to completely remove out of the land. So it's a very anti-God movement what we have here. Now, interestingly, so this resolution, in the last thing, so we urge here, resolved. So they want the House of Representatives, they want not only condemn the people, okay, Olga, but they urge all Americans, regardless of our beliefs or partisan affiliation, to seek information from authoritative sources and to engage in political debate from a common factual foundation. So I put this here up my for quite some time. I'm working under the name of Ephraim and put up here a law and order package quite some time ago. And I present you here the common source, the common groundwork for all people. I mean, as I can see, it's like every president of the United States of America took their Bible and they swore on their Bible. With the hand on the Bible, so may God help me. So may God help me. And so we know, of course, this was a very important moment here in St. John's Church. Also Donald Trump, his name is, you know, middle name John. And so we take a look at when we take a look at the Gospel of John, it's a very interesting thing. So he was standing before the St. John's Church. And when we take a look at the pictures, Trump before St. John Church, we take a look at the pictures. Now we see here that it's actually here, so very clearly. So this is here the house number, John 1525. So when we take a look now at you go to any Bible server, I'm using BibleServer.com, and we put in here John 1525. You will see that it's very fitting. But the word that is written in their law must be fulfilled. They hated me without cause. Now, when we take a look at the text, and I found this quite interesting, so the house, they bring out various resolutions. Now, this is a resolution from September 25, 2020, so 2 days after the guys blew the shofar. Now, there was another resolution. No? This is House Resolution 6666. So this is the House of Representatives who are wanting to make a bill for Gates, I think. But anyway, so this bill grants about $100 billion. $100 billion with a B, not $100 million, $100 billion. Yeah, for the tracking and whatnot for COVID. Well, we know today, many, many people know, it's a hoax, guys. It's a hoax. Now, so the interesting thing is now, when we go to, we all know where it's written. It's everything is in Revelation 13. We have the 666. Yeah. So a lot of people were actually thinking about this, you know, how this is related with the with the calculation of the number of the beast. A lot of people. So, and a lot of people say it's a conspiracy theory. Now, I have here the English Standard Version. So I don't know if it's a good translation. Normally, I use the NIV, you know, and New International, the Nearly Infallible Version. Now, and we have here for, you know, everybody can read this. This is the beast out of the earth, the second beast. Now, the first beast, this is, you know, as been a long time ago. This was the 11th of February 1929, when Mussolini gave power to the Pope to form the Vatican's kingdom. This one here. So this Pope and this kingdom, yeah, it's a real kingdom. It's a real kingdom. That means the Pope is a real king. He's a real king. And when he says, okay, listen, guys, you know, you should take a look at what is the Sunday of God. You should take a look into the Word of God. Aperuit illis means he has opened. he has opened. Yeah? So it's quite significant to understand that this Pope is indeed the eighth king of a kingdom which was created by Mussolini in the Lateran Treaty. Now, so this was the first beast, and we know then the Holocaust came, and it's very important to understand that here it was given power to wage war against God's holy people and to conquer them. And it was given authority over every tribe, people, languages, and nations. And just last year, on the 25th of September 2015, yeah, so the Pope came, Pope United Nations. Now, first of all, on the 23rd, he visited Obama. On the 24th, he was speaking in the Congress. And a day later, 25th of September, 5 years ago, so he was speaking in the General Assembly. And dear friends, you know, I urge you to read the speech, what he actually said, especially what he said in the White House, what he said, you know, on the lawn. He was speaking about climate change. Then on the 24th, he was speaking in Congress, speaking again on climate change and taking care. And so did he do in the General Assembly. So this is 5 years ago. 5 years ago. Now last year, now he brought out this one, the Motu Proprio. And you have to understand that the second beast, yeah, and I saw a second beast coming out of the earth. It had two horns like a lamb, but it spoke like a dragon. And this, dear ladies and gentlemen, has been Obama. And it's very unfortunately that nobody actually, you know, came out with this. I really, really wondered. So anyway, it exercised all the authority of the first beast on its behalf and made the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast whose fatal wound had been healed. So the wound was that the Pope, 150 years ago, lost all his worldly power. Yeah, after 1,000 years of Holy Roman Empire of German nations, so the Pope lost all his worldly power and was sitting in darkness for about 59 years until, well, Mussolini gave the first Pope a kingdom, yeah, in the Lateran Treaty, all right? But then Obama came, and Obama, it was Obama who gave the power to the beast, to this Congress. Now, and oops, so now here we see, of course, well, here in the background, you see now Sleepy Joe. Now, a bit later, we saw Nancy Pelosi standing there and shredding the speech Donald Trump gave. Why? Nancy Pelosi is Catholic. Joe Biden is Catholic. And these leftist guys, well, they decided to support the socialist Pope. Yeah, so it's, I don't know how more easy I can tell you this. So it is on 13/3/13, exactly 7 years to the day. A lot of, you know, who was ever following Q, a lot of things went down. So the whole communication of the deep state via video games and so on came down. It was on the 7th year of the inauguration of the vote of this Pope Francis, who is a socialist by heart and made the biggest changes in theology and Catholic faith you can imagine. So he is the inventor, if you like, of the climate religion. And he was put into power by the by Obama, by the Clintons, and by Soros. And dear friends, you know, if you check this up, you know, you will find out very easy that it is. And here it says, and it performed great signs, even causing fire to come down from heaven to the earth in full view of the people. Well, Obama, I think, was the most draconic president with 400 executive order killings and 2,400 drone deaths. Because of the signs, it was given power to perform on behalf of the first beast, it deceived the inhabitants of the earth. It ordered them to set up an image in order of the beast who was wounded by the sword and yet lived. So it cannot be more specific when you say, yes, they built up a complete image for this beast. You all think it's a holy father. There is nothing holy on this person, all right? He's not even a father. Think about this. All right, but everybody is bowing down to him because he was given power over all languages, over all nations, over all tribes, and everybody is bowing down to him, dear friends. All right, now, because of the signs, it is now it's it says here, the second beast was given power to give breath to the image of the first beast, so that the image could speak and cause all who refuse to worship the image to be killed. Yeah? Now that is currently what is happening now. I mean, if you are continuing, now this is what's happening with this, with this resolution. They want to kill people who have a different opinion, and they even take the censorship from Facebook, Twitter, and Google have removed or blocked QAnon groups and content from their platforms for violating their policies against misinformation, bullying, hate speech, and harassment. So I've never seen a more violent and more lying crowd than the Democrats, than anything else. But this is not hate speech. So when you accuse Mr. President of lying and that he is Goebbels and stuff like this, no, that's not hate speech and that's not harassment. It's not, that is leftist free speech, new speech, yeah? And is in connection here with this beast, with beast, okay? And it's in direct connection. That if they also forced all people, great and small, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their hand, on their right hands, or on their foreheads, so that they could not buy or sell unless they had the mark, which is the name of the beast or the number of its name. This calls wisdom. Let the person who has insight calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of the man. That number is 666, okay? And his name is Bill. You know, I'm just joking now. It's not base, but it's... think about this, testing, reaching, and contacting everyone. Trace. They want to trace you. They want to trace you exactly like everything. They want to control what you say, what you think, and if you do not bow down to the image, well, then the power of the beast is coming. Now, this resolution was done on May 1st, which happened to be the Law Day of the United States. And I really would like to point out that Donald Trump, you know, made a proclamation on that day. No? So, and it was countered, if you like, it was countered by the Democrats that they said, no, we don't want to stick to the law. We want to make new laws. Now, therefore, Donald Trump decides. So it says here, on this day, to honor our shared inheritance. Now, therefore, I, Donald J. Trump, President of the United States of America, in accordance with Public Law 8720, as amended, I do hereby proclaim May 1, 2020 as Law Day USA. I urge all Americans, including government officials, to observe this day by reflecting upon the importance of the rule of law in our nation and displaying the flag of the United States in support of this national observance. And I especially urge the legal profession, the press, the radio, television, and the media industry to promote and to participate in the observance end of this day. Now, unfortunately, they did not go with the Constitution. They want to promote Corona, 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 Corona. Now, Corona means crown. Corona means crown. And it's very important now that we take a look at this. Who's the source? In John 11:54. Yeah. So first of all, I hope you understand that this beast here in Revelation 13, well, this is Obama and the Pope, and I hope that you understand what this says for a profound impact. A profound impact. You know, especially now in combination with religious freedom. Religious freedom. Why is this so important with religious freedom? Now, because everybody waits that the Son of God returns. And it says here, in witness thereof, I have hereto set my hand in 29th day of April in the year of our Lord 2020 and of the independence of the United States of America 244. It's printed out. So we are in the year of our Lord 2020. 2020. Now, and it is very important to understand why that the Revelation, the book of the Revelation, talks about, of course, who is coming back. Now, in the Revelation 17, the Apocalypse of Q, we will find a very, very, very nice picture about the beast. About the beast and the ten horns and so on and so on and so on. And there is also a... an inscription, let's say. So, this calls for mind with wisdom. You know, we had before, we're calculating, the seven heads are seven hills on which the woman sits, Rome. There are also seven kings. Five have fallen, one is, the other has not yet come. But when he does come, he must remain only for a little while. The beast, who once was and now is an eighth king. He belongs to the seven and is going to his destruction. So it is very important to understand that this person is indeed the eighth king. And since his inauguration, we have two popes. We have a German, Pope Benedict, and we have a South American. Now, a liberation theologian from South America, from Argentina. So he's the eighth king, and he is also from the seven. All right? So it's very important to understand that he is really the beast. All right? Now, what we are experiencing now is that in order to bring the beast down, we need another 10 kings. The 10 horns you saw are 10 kings who have not yet received a kingdom, but who for 1 hour will receive authority as kings along with the beast. They have one purpose and give their power with the power and authority to the beast. They will wage war against the Lamb, but the Lamb will triumph over them because he is the Lord of lords and King of kings, and with him will be his called, chosen, and faithful followers. Now, a lot of people think now Jesus is coming out of thin air and raptures them. It's a very bad issue, but I can promise you. So let's quickly go to when we found this in the Bible, and this is very important. So why is on May 1, they make the number 666, and why they make a resolution against, no, on September 25 for 1145. So let's take a look what John says. Now, And we come to the, basically, we come to the resurrection of Lazarus, and where the high priest actually ordered Jesus to be killed. And then we come here, therefore, Jesus no longer moved about publicly amongst the people of Judea. Instead, he withdrew to a region near the wilderness, to a village called Ephraim, where he stayed with his disciples. Now, it's very important to understand here that even here in the Second Vatican Council, Ephraim. So Ephraim appears also here in this scripture. It's the holy Ephraim, because Ephraim is, according to the Bible, the firstborn son of God, Jeremiah 31:9. And it happens to be, there will be come with weeping, they will pray as I bring them back, I will lead them beside streams of water on a level path where there will no stumble, because I am Israel's father and Ephraim is my firstborn son. So, in the Jewish calendar, so this was now Yom Kippur, we talk about the 28th of September, we just had yesterday, Yom Kippur ended, blew the shofar. So what do Jewish, Orthodox Jewish people pray when they want to bless their children? Before entering the synagogue, it is customary for fathers to bless their children. Although there is no required formula for this blessing, it is customary for fathers to say, May God make you like Ephraim and Manasseh. So why is that? Because of Genesis 48. Okay? So we hear a lot about the Jewish people. We hear a lot about the Jewish people, and we are very lucky that they are home, absolutely. But in the line of succession, who really Israel is? Well, the sons of Joseph are the true Israel. And we read this in Genesis 48, where, we see that Israel is blessing the children of Joseph. All right? But Israel reached out his right hand and put it on Ephraim's head. Though he was the younger and crossing his arms, he put his left hand on Manasseh's head, even though Manasseh was the firstborn. Then he blessed Joseph and said, May the God before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac walked faithfully, the God who has been my shepherd all my life to this day, the angel who has delivered me from all harm, may he bless these boys. May they be called my name and the names of my fathers Abraham and Isaac, and may they increase greatly on the earth. When Joseph saw his father placing the head on Ephraim's head, he was displeased. So he took hold of his father's hand to move it from Ephraim's head to Manasseh's head. Joseph said to him, No, father, this one is the firstborn. Put your right hand on his head. But his father refused and said, I know, my son, I know. He too will become a people and he too will become great. Nevertheless, his younger brother will be greater than he, and his descendants will become a group of nations, United Nations and the United States. He blessed them that day and said, In your name will Israel pronounce this blessing. May God make you like Ephraim, for Manasseh. So he put Ephraim ahead of Manasseh. Then Israel said to Joseph, I'm about to die, but God will be with you and take you back to the land of your fathers. And I think everybody agree, yes, Israel is there. The United States opened up an embassy for the 70th anniversary of the state of Israel, All right. It opened up the embassy. And so it is absolutely 100% clear that the Jews are back in the land. Now, the big question is, where is Ephraim? Where is Ephraim? Where is Ephraim? Now, Ephraim, in the meantime, while he sent like quite a number of stuff to the Vatican, we've been everywhere, and then invite you to, you know, I sent some invitations already out to some Q guys. Now, these are all the books we already published, where the first one is already like now about 2 years old, which is called Ephraim's Letters. There are all the letters inside we sent to Donald Trump, to the ambassador of Israel, and of course to various other people, including Mike Pompeo. Now, for a lot of people, they will be shocked to learn that the 1260 days of Revelation in chapter 11 and chapter 12, well, they are over. They are absolutely over. And this is why we are experiencing now the last stand of the beast. Now, the only way out of this, yeah, and I invite you, take a look at this here. It's 1 hour long. You can, you know, you can also watch this on YouTube. Yeah, so this for now 5 years, basically, for 5 years, I tried to contact everybody and say, listen, guys, I'm very, very, very sorry. I don't want to offend anybody. But the son of David, well, he died. Who will come will be the son of Joseph. And I really would like to go with you to Isaiah 7. For the English speaker, because here we see that in chapter 7, it declared that because of the sin of Ephraim, he was cut off as a people, and Ephraim is called Samaria. It's in Isaiah. Now, this was the sign for Ephraim. Now, this happened 734 BC. Before the common era, before the Lord, before the coming of Jesus of Nazareth. And it says here very clearly that Ephraim is Samaria. Now, there was also another sign, but I said, I will not ask, I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, hear now, you house of David. And I would like to point out that here, Rabbi Yoel Berger, which is here to the left here, so he is indeed, literally, physically, from the house of David. Literally from the house of David. Now, here, house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of humans? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and he will be called Emmanuel. Now, all Christian believers, they know, they believe this is Jesus from Nazareth, because this is what it says in John 1. Okay? This is says over in the gospel that this is the Emmanuel. So the Emmanuel came the first time, well, in 2,000 years ago. 2,000 years ago. But here it continues. It continues into Isaiah 8. And into Isaiah 8, it is very important to mention that it's specifically it says, do not call conspiracy everything this people calls a conspiracy. Do not fear what they fear. Do not dread it. So this year, we have four times the word conspiracy, 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 conspiracy. So how often do they call conspiracy in this document? Let me check. 19 times, guys. 19 times in this document is the word conspiracy. 19 times. Yeah. So the believers and those who are trusting the Lord and read the Bible, they should not call this conspiracy. Absolutely not. This is not a conspiracy. Absolutely. Yeah, but what we are doing, we are urged, all Americans, we are urged, regardless of our belief or partisan affiliate, to seek information from authoritative sources. Now, this is the most authoritative source you can ever encounter. This is the Bible. This is the Word of God. And the Word of God tells you, do not call conspiracy everything these people call conspiracy. Yeah, and then it continues a bit later, no, because many of them will stumble. This is conspiracy because this conspiracy, you know, is hitting currently Israel. It's hitting the most Bible-believing country on this planet, the United States of America. Yeah, one nation under God, and they call everything conspiracy. Now you should not. The Lord Almighty is the one you are regard as holy. He is the one you are to fear. He is the one you are to dread. He will be a holy place for both Israel and Judah. He will be a stone that causes people to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. For the people of Jerusalem, he will be a trap and a snare. And I ask you to really think about this now extremely, super literal. The Sanhedrin has my information. Everybody else has also the inhabitants of Jerusalem have my information. Now, these are the people from Judah. Now, the questioner, do you belong to Ephraim and the people of Israel? Because the house of Israel and the house of Judah are two different pair of shoes, so to speak. All right? So it's very important to understand. Yeah, many of them will stumble. They will fall and be broken. They will be snared and captured. Bind up this testimony and warning and seal up God's instruction amongst my disciples. Now, there is actually my Torah. Yeah? I will wait for the Lord who is hiding his face from the descendants of Jacob. I will put my trust in him. In God we trust. It's written on your $1 bill. And then it says here very clearly, here I am and the children the Lord has given me. We are signs and symbols in Israel from the Lord Almighty who dwells on Mount Zion. So where should the Revelation, we were in Revelation 13, okay, it's ending with 666, but the very next verse, and then I looked and there before me was the Lamb standing on Mount Zion. Now, currently these guys, Mount Zion is a bit to the left, currently nobody is standing on Mount Zion, the Lamb neither, but the Mount Zion is in direct connection, with number one, with the number of the beast, 666, but also with Isaiah 18. And I ask you now also for all your Bible-believing Christians who cannot believe, I told many people, I said, listen guys, I'm very, very sorry, Jesus is not coming. It will be Ulf Diebel from Düsseldorf. And you cannot help it. It is that so. This is the very reason that Aperuit Illis, appeared. Ah, here, Saint Ephraim, they call it a bit different. Yeah. It is very important to understand that in the resurrection, okay, Luke 24. And a lot of people completely forgot that. So now we are talking about the risen Jesus. And there are people walking in Jerusalem. One of them claimed Cleopas, asked him, are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days? So a lot of people went to Jerusalem. Mike Pompeo went to Jerusalem. Donald Trump went to Jerusalem. I mean, this is all about here. It's about Jerusalem. It's about, oh, look at this here, a presidential message on Rosh Hashanah. Okay, so everything is basically about Jerusalem. Everything. So the question is, have you been in Jerusalem? Have you been a witness to Jerusalem? And so on. Now, he said, what things? About Jesus of Nazareth, they replied. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our ruler handed him over. So now, so what he's doing, what he says, and he said to them, how foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets had spoken. I just read you. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. So this is the absolutely, that is the absolutely make it or break it. So every person who claims Messiah, the son of Joseph, son of David, he has to completely take his, explain to all the people how he got there. How he got there via Moses and all the prophets. And I really have to take you now to Ezekiel, to the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 37. Because this is the chapter of the resurrection of the dead. The resurrection of the dead. Where it says, I will put my spirit in you and you will live and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken and I have done, declares the Lord. So when people are now, and you can watch this via YouTube, think about how miraculously it is this, that you can now see people in Jerusalem standing on the Mount of Olives, blowing the shofar, and so on. This wasn't possible until up to several years ago, and people absolutely, completely brain dead because of that speaking image you built up for the Pope. And it says here, continuing, so the Spirit of God was put into people and now the scripture has been fulfilled and people are already settling in their land again. The word of the Lord came to me, son of man, take a stick of wood and write on it, belonging to Judah and the Israelites associated with him. Then take another stick of wood and write to it on it, belonging to Joseph, that is to Ephraim, and all the Israelites associated with him. Join them together in one stick so that they will become one in your hand. Two sticks becoming one. I don't want to go into this, how this is all related to 9/11, okay, where the two towers became one, but it's this is a sign. When you people ask, won't you tell us what you mean by this, I say, this is what the sovereign Lord says. I am going to take the stick of Joseph, which is in Ephraim's hand, and of the Israel tribes associated with him, and join it to Judah's stick. I will make them into a single stick of wood, and they will become one in my hand. So this is the biggest promise God gave and is completely entrenched in Jeremiah 31. Jeremiah 31, which everybody read in the synagogue on Rosh Hashanah. There will be a day when watchmen cry out on the hills of Ephraim, come, let us go up to Zion to the Lord our God. So it's not only that we have a full information site, no, we have also like a sign-up page where you can receive your exclusive EFI card. Yeah, so you can set and you say, yes, I want to belong to the nation of Ephraim, you know, as you belong to the nation of Judah. Why? Because the house of Israel, well, they are like, what can I say? It's the stupid Germans, you know, totally blind Germans. And the house of Judah, well, these are the black hats. No, the black hats and the white hats has nothing to do with this. So these are the guys who are wearing black apparel because they are in complete destruction for the temple. They are sad for sadness. Okay, so the temple was destroyed by Rome. By Rome. And now there is a Dome of the Rock. And this guy, well, he said that, we don't want to go into this. I do another video. But the fact is that we prepared everything in Germany that you can order you a little card, and you can belong literally to the house, to the nation of Ephraim, because this is what it's all about. Yeah, so this is what it looks like. You can have like a little card here, pop, you know, so where you can put in your name and address, and we ask you to make a new deal with us. Why? Well, because it says so here. Oops, sorry. Because it says so here. Now, after Ephraim is born, so he has to go to Jerusalem. He has to leave there with the age of 40. Then he has to be cut off for 7 years. And then he has to survive 2,300 days of abomination of desolation. Yeah, which ended, you know, on 9/11. Just a couple of weeks ago. We do this in another video, but here is the but this is how it goes, you know. So once Ephraim is first born, so then at some point he has to leave, and now there is a return. I have surely heard Ephraim mourning, you discipled me like an unruly calf, and I have been discipled. So restore me and I will return, because you are the Lord my God. After I strayed, I repented. After I came to understanding, I beat my hip. It's very interesting. It's not breast, it's hip. I was ashamed and humiliated because I bore the disgrace of my youth. Is not Ephraim my dear son, the child in whom I delight? Though I speak often against him, I still remember him. Therefore my heart yearns for him. I have great compassion for him, declares the Lord. So Ephraim is indeed the lost son. So, and he is the virgin Israel. Virgin Israel, return to your towns. So this is Revelation 12, when the virgin gives birth to the child. So, and we talk this very literally. It says here, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. Now think about Abraham Accord. Abraham had sons, Isaac and Ishmael. Isaac had Jacob and Esau, and Israel, Jacob, had 12 sons. Okay, these 12 sons, well, divided between the people of Israel and the people of Judah. Now again, these are the people of Judah. We congratulate all. And so, oh, we are so happy that you're back in Israel. Well, super duper good. Why you forget Israel? Why do people forget Israel? Yeah? Because we said we are from Israel. It's a matter, this is why you have the international religious freedom thing. Okay, we go back to this here. This is exactly why we have this advancing and defending international religious freedom through diplomacy. It is very, very important, because Christians honestly believe, okay, that he is the representative of Christ. So this is, so they didn't find out, oh, it's the Antichrist. Now, of course, the people from the house, Nancy Pelosi and so, well, they don't care. They don't care. They call everything a conspiracy. Yeah? But we have to understand that this is a major issue, that people do not look to the Pope as a true Antichrist, as the true Antichrist who has to be replaced, because he was brought in by Obama and, you know, Joe Biden and Nancy Pelosi. They are so good Catholics. Okay, and then, of course, we have Bernie Sanders. And then we have, of course, Adam Schiff, and all these other great Jewish persons who say, well, we don't care, you know, we stick with this New World Order. Hmm? But the Bible says there will be a new covenant. So this is the new covenant we offered. We said, okay, we are Israel, I am Ephraim, and we invite everybody. So what does this entitle? Well, you have to make a new deal with us. And because the old deal is completely, absolutely, completely broken by the Democrats. I've never seen something like this, you know. It's very, very bad. Now, tonight there will be a live recording or a live the debate, the first debate. It will be very interesting to see, you know, how Sleepy Joe will do. But Sleepy Joe thinks about conspiracy theories like Nancy Pelosi. And it is up to you. If you believe that Jesus is picking you up, he is coming out of the clouds. Well, this is not so, yeah, because it absolutely say that the in Hebrews, in the letters to the Hebrews, okay, God's final words, okay, we, so how do you recognize the firstborn from the dead, and why is it not Jesus? You know, it can't be Jesus, because Jesus is dead, you know, he died for us. Yeah? It says here clearly, yet, as we know, but we do not see. So it's not angel that he prepares somebody again, but Jesus and by one of the miraculous by gifting according to his will. It's not the angel that there will be a place where someone has said, what is mine? Who made them little, no, in putting everything left nothing yet. But we do seizing in burning sun of somebody one of makes family and also sorry. I really have to check this now in German. It's really interesting. This is how that is not a sorry, you know, I once a while have to check in German, you know, cross reference. Now, okay, in Hebrew second, yeah. So number one, go back to Hebrews first. Now, it says here, first of all, the firstborn, the heir, he has to be born again, a second time. You know, it's, you know, don't ask me, you know, anything about reincarnation. In Hebrew, it's called Gilgul. Yeah. So you are born again through spirit and water, as Jesus says. When it says also that the Son, for to who, which of the angels did God ever say, you are my son, today I have become your father, or again, I will be his father and he will be my son. And again, when God brings his firstborn into the world, he says, let all God's angels worship him. So the firstborn has to be born again, a second time, when God brings him into the earth. And there is even a law, I will not talk about this, but a law about this. But what are the signs of this Emmanuel? These are the children, the children. So the children from Isaiah 8:18. It says here very clearly that he says, I will declare your name to my brethren and sisters in the assembly. I will sing your praises. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, it says, here I am and the children God has given me. So I know that you know that Jesus from Nazareth, well, he never ever had children. Never. But I do. Okay? The children of Ephraim. And here it says, this is the key of understanding. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity so that he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. So, and this is currently what's going on. The fear of death is put into people because of pandemic. No, pandemic. Pan was a, no, Pan is a god, and demonic, well, pandemonic, it's whatever, you know. So this is the fear and so on, which was put in people. And what can I say? I work to all the time. It says, yes, my children, I have children of flesh and blood, the children of Ephraim. Yeah, from Zechariah 9:9. Yeah. Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion, shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victoriously, rowly and riding on a donkey. So this is how I came to Jerusalem, without one penny on my box. And I left with the children. I came to Israel, to American States, to the United States, actually. But it continues here. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations, Ephraim. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the rivers to the sea. So why? Because this guy is going, and then one single person has to have the freedom to proclaim, I'm sorry, guys, it's me. I cannot say anything different. I have the king. I found everything out. I went to the Vatican. I deposited my stuff. And 1 year later, after I've been there, well, they came out. He has opened. And Aperuit Illis, it's an executive order that every Catholic is ordered to live by. Now, and now, exactly 1 year later, we are now in Rome, Italy. Again, talking about religious freedom. Now, can you imagine? Think about this, okay? Now, I know a lot of people are actually totally believe that Jesus will taking them out of, you know, into the heavens, the rapture. But think about if this is not so. How is this possible that one person, one son of man has the possibility and say, sorry guys, it's me. He needs religious freedom. He needs to be able to tell this without being killed. Because this is one of the biggest threats I'm now under for the last 5 years. Since I said, okay, I'm sorry, guys, I'm Ephraim, I'm doing my job as priest of the order of Melchizedek, that people wanted to burn me because they think I do not believe in Jesus. But it's only because of Jesus. It's only because of Jesus. Very important. Because Jesus died, the son of Joseph gave his life for the son of David gave his life for the son of Joseph. That's all it is. And when you do not have religious freedom, you're not able to explain this to the people. Okay? And this is now a very, very important point. That if you do not have religious freedom to say, hey, Chabad guys, hey, it's me, Effie, you wait for me. You know, hey guys, blowing the shofar, very nice. I have even a bigger shofar and a nicer shofar. And I blew this in the Vatican and everywhere. You know, you saw this, you know, in the trailer. If I do not have religious freedom, well, I'm dead. Because everybody wants to burn me. Everybody wants to burn me. It's a very difficult situation. And this is where you step in. When you expect, you know, the Son of God, when you expect the Son of Man, when you want, you know, you want to get rid of this, the Democrats, and so on and so on, and this resolution, well, I invite you to go to Ephraim.info or to Zion5777.com and make a new deal with me and stand with Israel and the Jewish people to bring back the kingdom of Israel back to Jerusalem. So I hope this was a bit, not too much. If you have any questions, you know, you can put this down in the remarks downstairs, you know, in the, of course, in the commentary sections. Otherwise, you know, I would be very glad to accommodate, download this study group. It's quite a number of books we already written, and they're all published. They're over 300 euros in, you know, when you buy them from Amazon. Also, the Son of God is a son of man, just filled with the Holy Spirit. So also you can become a son of God. Of course, when you are born out of the Spirit, out of water and Spirit, you become a son of God. And you will be called children of God. Now, that doesn't mean that only because you're the son of God and so on, you do not need cash. Because, you know, people think, oh, it's so ridiculous. Everybody can read that the son of God is coming through the clouds. Well, that's not true. You know, he has to pay the airport to plane ticket. He has to inform people. And if you take a look that for shutting people down, well, there are 100 billion to chip people and to shut them down. I hope that you understand when I bring out my life. I said, okay, I'm very sorry, guys, but you have to make a sign up and you have to also pay something, because only when you pay something, well, then it's also worth something. Otherwise, there will be no freedom. And you have, I did this as a job, as a priest of the Order of Melchizedek. You can take a look at all questions and answers. Here we have an FAQ sections where we hope I can, you know, answer all your questions. You get in touch with me. Otherwise, I hope now to reach Mike Pompeo. So he is coming on Friday to Dubrovnik, to Croatia, where I am currently. And I'm very hopeful that finally we can solve the issue in Zion. And I hope that you are on board. Thank you.